and welcome to Hazard and Hope. I'm Ed, and in this episode we're looking at how you can design and adapt your walls to be more flood resilient. So here we go. This episode of Hazard and Hope is sponsored by the Scottish Flood Forum. So first things first, why would you need to make your walls more flood resilient? Well, as we can see here, they can be a route and point through which floodwater enters a building. And if not designed to be flood recoverable or flood resistant, they can absorb, swell, distort, or be structurally damaged by the forces from floodwater. And you know, the recovery and reinstatement process can be messy, lengthy, and stressful. But it really doesn't have to be this way. Making the walls of your building more flood resilient can actually help to limit floodwater entry into the building. And in the event that floodwater does come inside, having flood recoverable wall finishes can mean they're quicker to dry out, decontaminate, or you know, may not even need to be removed post flood. And this can save a huge amount of stress, disruption, and expense for repair, as well as potentially reducing the time you spend out of a building. Now in this episode, we're going to focus on adaptation strategies relating to walls. But you might also find the episode we've made on how to make your floors more flood resilient of interest as well. But jumping back to flood resilient walls, this type of adaptation falls within the remit of property flood resilience, also known as PFR. And in this episode, we're going to be looking at a combination of resistance, recoverable, and avoidance-based approaches to PFR in relation to the walls of the building. But whichever way we're approaching this topic, it's important to follow the PFR process, as you can see here. And this is set out in more detail in the Code of Practice for Property Flood Resilience. We've got the link to this in the description just below this video, but we've also made a bit of an overview episode that might be of interest as well. And whilst we're on the topic of particularly useful links, it's worth checking out this particular British standard as it outlines the performance expectations of wall finishes. And we've put the link to this in the description just below the video. But back to the PFR process. Now, as we can see here, the first thing to consider with any strategy is the flood hazard, because the type of flooding will hugely influence the actual range of materials and approach to PFR that would be suitable for your given context. Yeah, if you're in something like a coastal setting, there could, for example, be the risk of impact through waves or high velocity flows from something like a storm surge. And really, there are many different forces and loads at play on a building when it does flood. You know, the walls can be hit by large debris like trees and cars, and you know, there could be scarring and erosion from waves and high velocity flows. And as you can see here, there are many different ways in which floodwater can enter a property. It doesn't just have to come in through the front door, and it can seep in through party walls and cracks in brickwork. And if the building's fabric and its contents are not flood recoverable, then there can be a vast amount of damage and disruption caused. Now, when it comes to restricting water from entering into a building, we have actually made an episode that looks at property flood resistance measures. And in this, you can find more details on the different types of measures that you might use, such as flood doors or temporary deployable barriers. But we do need to remember that resistance-based approaches to PFR won't necessarily be suited on every construction type or flood risk context. And the material's characteristics will influence whether it actually needs to be ripped out, and I suppose the amount of type of drying or reinstatement that is required. And you can see here, actually, there are a range of different characteristics to consider when it comes to the performance of different materials. Now, with something like solid walls, it's obviously important to identify the actual material of which the building is built, as this influences its different water transportation properties. We also need to consider things like its thickness, coursing, and the actual type of mortar that's used for bonding. I mean, even with something like a brick, you know, there are a range of different types of bricks out there, and each has different levels of performance when it comes to flood water. Yeah, engineering bricks, for example, tend to be higher density and less porous, and I suppose the actual quality of mortar joints is also crucial to consider as well, as you know, flood water can penetrate through the cracks in mortar as well as brickwork. And for many historic properties, the actual wall type and construction material will mean it actually may not be possible to make the building highly flood resistant or fit additional measures for that purpose. In those cases, it may actually be that you look to use recoverable and or avoidance-based approaches to PFR so that there's minimal damage to the actual building's fabric and its contents if or when floodwater enters the property. Now, when it comes to cavity walls, the cavities and any voids can act as a route of floodwater entry and even affect the actual structural stability of the property. Now, issues can also arise in actually drying out cavities, particularly where vulnerable types of insulation have been fitted, and yeah, they can end up filling up with silt and sediment. So where possible, we should look to try and provide access to the cavity to facilitate drying. And you can also get things like covers for weep holes to actually stop water getting into the cavity space in the first place. Now, frame-based construction systems and techniques, such as those out of timber, metal, or precast elements, will obviously have different capacities for loading than solid or cavity masonry walls. Now, the benefits of these different systems is that they can be designed without cavities, or ones that are actually easy to access, and made for more flood-resistant or recoverable materials. But with modular systems, it can be important to consider actually how it would perform with horizontal loading of water, and actually the way in which joints between the building elements will be sealed to limit water ingress. Now, structural reinforcement can be retrofitted internally or externally to the walls of a building, or into the cavity areas. But additional loading of flood water should be accounted for when actually specifying the extent, type, and position of any reinforcement. And in terms of the actual apertures in the walls themselves, there are obviously a range of different types of flood resistance measures, such as flood doors, that can help to actually limit and restrict water entry. For air bricks and weep holes at lower level, you can clip on covers or actually retrofit and specify something like an automatic air brick to help to slow and stop any water getting into that underfloor void. Now, the service entry points for pipes, cables, and ducts can also be a route of flood water entry. Where possible, the points at which they actually go into the building's fabric should be located up and at a higher level. And for any services entering the property, watertight seals can be used with waterproof mastic or silicone sealant. But these should be inspected on a regular basis just to be sure there hasn't been any degradation or damage to the joints themselves. Now, another approach to actually improve the flood resilience of your walls can be to use waterproof external wall finishes, such as an external render or high-quality waterproof paint onto masonry. And sealants such as waterproof repellent coatings or damp-proof masonry creams can also be used. Or it might be that you actually use a tanking system to help limit the transference of water through the fabric of the building. And you often see this type of approach being used in the construction of basements. Now, in this approach, the surfaces are actually sealed using membrane systems, and they're designed to direct water down to perimeter drainage channels around the actual base of the walls. And the water can actually then be removed using pump and sump systems. But do bear in mind that this approach will not necessarily be appropriate for every construction material or type, as you know, it can affect drying, displace water to neighbouring properties, and even alter the actual structural loads on the building. Now, when it comes to the actual insulation within the walls itself, commonly used types such as mineral wool or fibre insulations can act like sponges when they come into contact with flood water. They retain moisture and it can make it really difficult to dry out the building. In terms of strategies, closed cell and spray applied insulation can be more resilient choices, as they don't absorb moisture to the same degree as mineral wool. And this type of insulation can come in a variety of different forms. So it can be in bats, injected into things like a cavity, or actually spray applied to the wall itself. But you do need to select the appropriate grade, and the performance of it will be affected if it's used in environments that are wet frequently or for prolonged periods of time. Alternatively, it could be that the insulation is actually moved to be fitted on the internal or external wall layer, rather than the actual inside of the cavity itself. And this can make it easier to dry out, but you might also consider actually positioning, you know, resilient insulation materials in the areas that are exposed to flood risk, you know, at those lower levels, and then using more vulnerable types of insulation above those predicted flood levels. Next, let's look at the actual linings of the walls themselves. And we'll begin by looking at a plaster wall. Now, when flood water comes into contact with cement-based plasters, it can saturate them, and the material may need to be chipped off to avoid damp, mold, or even rot. This removal can be a noisy, messy, and very invasive process. Another approach is actually to use lime and cement-based plasters. And these can dry out more naturally and may not actually need to be removed from the wall post-flood. You can also add water-resistant adhesives to these surfaces, and these can help to limit the movement of salts through the material. Or it may be that you actually only specify plaster for use above that predicted flood datum, and then use this threshold as something that informs the interior design and style of the room. Next, let's look at plasterboard. Now, when floodwater meets standard plasterboard, which can often be gypsum-based, it only takes the bottom corner of a board to get soggy, for it to swell, distort, and ultimately need to be ripped off and reinstated. Now, what you might do instead is actually use flood-resilient waterproof boards. and these can be cement-based or magnesium oxide boards. These can often be designed for use in things like wet rooms and often perform better in longer floods and depending on the context, may actually not necessarily need to be removed post-flood. It could also be that you actually install them in a horizontal rather than a vertical orientation, so that those parts of the wall of which are at greater risk of flooding are actually covered with resilient plasterboard. And then above that level, in those areas where it's at less risk of flooding, you can just use much more standard plasterboards. And I suppose following on from that, it can also make sense to have a little gap between the two boards so that you minimize the risk of any wicking of moisture up between the boards. And that can help to improve access and ventilation, and you know, you might even cover this with an internal dado rail. And I suppose it goes without saying that any fixings of wall finishes shouldn't penetrate through flood-resistant membranes and coatings on the wall behind. Now, another approach might actually be that you change from plasterboard to recoverable marine plywood, or potentially even just have removable timber paneling. But it could be that you actually have a property with external exposed masonry areas. And for these, you might look to treat the surface with sealants to actually reduce staining and limit the uptake of moisture into the wall itself. Or you might actually look to use lime-based mortars, which, if correctly pointed, can help to reduce the transmission of moisture. Next, let's look at tiled walls. Now, there are a number of issues to consider here. Now, flood water can penetrate through the grouted joints between tiles or actually get at them from behind, and this moisture and these forces can cause those tiles to be pushed off the wall. Now, in terms of adaptation strategies, you might look to fit ceramic tiles that can be easily cleaned, or similar types which actually have low levels of porosity. And in these areas, it can make a lot of sense to use waterproof grout and really inspect the joints regularly. Now, you could also use something like a tanking system to limit water ingress behind those tiles, but you might also look to mount the tiles of the wall on an actual batten system to provide a bit of an air gap for drying and, I suppose, reduce the force on the tile itself. Now, the last type of wall we're going to look at is internal timber stud partitions. These can often be made of fast-growing softwoods and be damaged by flood water and may need to be ripped out and reinstated. Now, it might well be that you actually look to replace them with galvanized steel or an aluminium frame system. But you know, the timber itself could also be treated using preservatives or actually replaced and reinstated with hardwood studs. You might also look to add bracing to help avoid any warping and really be sure that any fixings are stainless steel, as you know, most timbers are acidic, and so that contact with water can cause corrosion. So that's a bit of an overview of just some of the approaches for making your walls more flood resilient. But remember that the suitability and selection does of course depend on the particular flood risk context, the property setup, its function, and the property owner's preferences. I suppose bear in mind that it might actually be that your property type isn't suited for particular PFR approaches. It may well be that you actually flood through your party wall with your adjacent property, and so really a joined up approach with your neighbours may be needed. And we have to remember, of course, that you know, many properties will have actually had extensions and alterations to them made over time, and these can actually be weak points which could undermine an approach or, I suppose, require it to be different in particular parts of the property. Now, a lot of this episode and discussions, I suppose, have been around the idea of retrofitting or upgrading the walls of an existing property to be more flood resilient. But these materials and strategies can, of course, be specified and fitted onto new build properties. And really, it's not just the bricks and mortar that will need to be adapted. I mean, any successful PFR setup will need to be operated and maintained in the right way. And I suppose that hierarchy and interconnectedness of materials needs to be really clearly communicated and documented in the handover pack. And a flood recovery plan needs to be put in place so that people know what actions they should take before, during, and after a flood event. And that period after a flood, when that drying and decontamination may need to occur, is really important to get right, because there's a lot of different factors to consider. And so we have put a range of different links to some guidance on the drying of buildings in the description just below this video. Now, in terms of next steps, if you yourself would like to make the walls or wall linings of your property more flood resilient, then what can you do? Well, the code of practice shows us the process that we need to go through. And ultimately, the first step is to get advice from a suitable professional on the flood hazard and the property setup, so they can actually help you review which options may be suitable for your given context and particular preferences. So thanks very much for listening. And if you'd like to keep updated on future episodes, then please subscribe below, hit the bell for notifications, and we look forward to seeing you soon.